So there was, I'm going to read this. There is kind of a test that we can take, that we can use as soon as somebody's coming to us with gossip, basically. You know, people just love to gossip. Why? Because they see it on TV 24 hours a day. I mean, it's nonstop gossip. That's all it is. It's not real facts. It's not real things. It's the propaganda of them trying to get you to think about and feel about things the way they want you to think and feel about. You're being played. You know, you're being created into another useful idiot for the Marxist government that's about to take us over. Okay. Often a person with an evil report will test your spirit to detect if you're opening to hearing it. He may ask you for your opinion of the person, or he may drop a negative comment about the person and watch your response. He may try to get your curiosity up by asking, "Have you heard about so-and-so?" He may pose as asking you for counsel on how to help this person, but you discover that he has no intention of helping the person. You may discover that he's already shared the situation with many others that had no need to know. Before we judge, we need to ask these questions. The questions are, what is your reason for telling me? Okay, somebody's going to say something about somebody. Ask them, what is your reason for telling me? Why? Because you know this person's a gossip anyway, so why don't you just teach them how to not gossip? So to stop them from their continued sinful behavior, say, what is the reason for telling me? If the only reason I need to know so that I can pray, I probably don't need to know. Okay, number two, where did you get this information? If the person will not reveal his sources, he is probably spreading rumors that are of an unreliable information. Yeah, we just watched that on Fox News for how long? Okay, it was just hearsay, but they wouldn't bring out, you know, the whistleblower. Okay, well, everybody knows who the whistleblower is. Even Trump tweeted his name. Okay, put that guy on the stage here. We're going to find out from his own name. No, nobody's going to give their sources. Why? Because it's gossip. That's what it is. Unreliable sources. Number three, have you gone to those directly involved to seek to restore them? Now, that's a really good question. If you're going to hear somebody say something bad about somebody, well, and they're going to bring you into this, you need to say, okay, what have you done to try to restore them into fellowship with God? What have you done to try to restore them into fellowship with a brother and sister in Christ? You're holding them accountable with this information they want to share with you. But most of the time, because we've been, you know, dumbed down in our response, because it's nonstop gossip from the news, it's not real news, it's gossip. It's not real news. Most of it's fake news. And so we're dumbed down. We just want to hear everything because it's just going to get us all excited and angry and mad and all that fun stuff. Have you gone to those directly involved to seek to restore them? Good question. If they have that information, they better do something about it. Because if they have it, they're going to be held accountable for God for that information to do something about, to bring their brother and sister back in a relationship with God. Number four, have you personally checked out all the facts? That's a goodie. Oh, you found that to be really true? Well, that normally doesn't come up in the conversation. Because you're not going to get a word in edgewise because they're so excited to tell you about all these nice, greasy things. If he has not gone directly to those involved and has not checked out the facts, he isn't interested in helping. If he really needs counsel on how to do it, he will not be asking for such help from several sources. One thing we can say, after you've gone to him, let me know how it went. So in other words, you're going to hold him accountable. Okay, go back to him talking about this stuff and let me know how it went. This holds him accountable. Number five, can I quote you if I check this out? So somebody's going to give you gossip. It's like, can I quote you? Why? Because if it's truly to restore somebody into fellowship, that means that that person has come to you seeing you as the spiritual adult in church and that you need someone spiritual to help you restore this one, as it says in Galatians 6, verse 1. Well, now you're going to take it seriously. Can I quote you to check out the source? Can I quote you? Why? Because you need to. Because, you know, have to have two witnesses, it says. If you go back to Matthew 18. Okay, if someone is spreading judgmental falsehoods or half-truths, he won't want to be quoted. And usually they don't want to be quoted there. Why? Because they don't want to get pulled into a fight. What are they going to do? They're going to set you up against that person, and they don't want to be involved. But they want to set this up and watch you fight. They want to stand back and watch you beat up on your neighbor and watch your neighbor beat up on you. They're just going to have so much fun. Yeah, I love watching this. Yes, people do that. Your next door neighbor does that. Lady across the street does that. All kinds of crazy folks love to set people against each other and watch them fight. Kathy's in-laws were like that. You know, everybody feared her grandmother on her ex's side, whatever. Anyway, and she would set the daughters up against each other and watch them fight. Now, I actually watch this in one of the buildings I do. So this one place, I got this atrium with all this lovely foliage everywhere. You know, of course, it's foliage everywhere, lots of foliage. Anyway, so here's these beautiful things. I got to trim them. They're growing so fast. They're so beautiful. They can grow this much. There's so much light to grow this much in a week. So in 2 weeks, I'll have this thing that's like, you know, 5 feet hanging down. I got to cut them off. So it looks all even. Well, so people want these cuttings, you know, they can grow their own, stick them in water, all that. And so this lady asked me for some. Okay, so I got some. I don't have just some. There's three floors of these plants. I have a lot. And so I come in with the first thing because I wanted to let her know, okay, yes, I'm listening to you. I'll give you some. And so I bring them in. And then her sister takes them from her. And then they're having this big cat fight. It's like, so I go in there. So I go to two floors and I have almost more than I can carry. And I bring it into her, into their break room and just put it on one of the tables in their break room. There you go. There's a whole bunch. It was just a cat fight between two sisters. I don't know if it's the dad who runs the place or whatever, but, you know, the mom and pop operations have, you know, these terrible, you know, interpersonal relationships because the programming that they had as little kids, they keep with them for the rest of their life. So the dysfunctionality of the family is now the dysfunctionality of the business. But all I have to say, I've watched this. And it's horrible in the church. For somebody who's going to go, this person over here, and did you hear this? I made a promise to myself and Kathy a long time ago, before we got married even, that I would not give her anybody's poison. Well, if somebody says something that somebody said about somebody else, and that's just hurtful, and that's just wrong, but they're saying it to you, what are you going to do? Well, I need to share it with that person. No, you're being a youthful idiot. You're going to be used to say the nasty thing that they didn't have the courage because they're a coward and they don't want to have the fight themselves. You're being used by Satan to accuse the brethren. And the person who's involved is using you to be their little demonic emissary to take that really nasty poison and give it to this person. Shame on you. Shame on us for being that stupid to be used by people to hurt somebody else. Now, if somebody's going to say something bad, oh, that somebody said this bad thing about, or somebody feels this bad way about Kathy, she's never going to hear about it, ever, in Jesus' name. It's going to die with me because she doesn't need to hear that poison. Our brothers and sisters in Christ do not need to be played, and they don't need to listen to any demonic poison. Satan is called the accuser of the brethren. And he is always working to make every single brother and sister in Christ look bad. We've all been the recipient of being looked bad, of being, you know, now nobody trusts me. Now somebody thinks this is my propensity. Now this and that and the other thing because of some nasty thing that somebody said. Well, where did it come from? Well, it was instigated by Satan. And his little demonic forces went in somebody's heart who loves to gossip. And they're going to go, yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, that's right. And they're going to think it's their own idea. Or they're going to see something now having this prejudice against this person because that's their propensity and go, oh yeah, that's, and I saw it happen. And I saw this person say those things to them. I mean, we can look at it and, oh yeah, these are fun dramas that we watch all day long. You know, all these soap operas, it's all about dysfunctional relationships. It's called sin. And why should we be entertained by sin? Shame on us for doing so. If there is something that God calls sin, don't bring it into your house. Don't let it influence your family or your mind or start thinking and acting the same way. No, we need to be transformed by God's word. And these things that really hurt when we read them, they should hurt because we are guilty of that. It should really hurt and it should bring us to repentance. And we should say, Lord Jesus, I don't want to ever do this again. Make me stop it. Show me before I continue this. And where does it start? The moment you hear something, the moment you have an idea that is now a prejudice against a certain person. Because it comes from the accuser of the brethren. You want to be an agent of Satan? Then run your mouth. And you'll hurt lots of people. And nobody will like you, and they'll walk on eggshells for the rest of your life. Do you like that? Who wants to have people walk on eggshells? But some people seem to like it because they, you know, some people really like it. And they live their life angry. And they're bitter. And of course, nobody likes them. And their brother and sister of Christ who has been completely taken over by a demonic entity to make him Satan's agent to accuse the brethren. But in their heart, they've justified themselves and they can put their head on the pillow and feel good about themselves because they are superior to all those bad people who are all doing all those bad things in church. If we get our feet off of that little thing of pride and get back down face first in the dirt with the gravel in the mouth on the face on the foot of the cross, knowing that we need a savior, and we see everybody else who's down there mourning over their sin, are we going to go look around and say, well, I'm not as bad of a sinner as somebody else? No, we're going to be rejoicing because we have such a savior who saved us. We would keep ourselves from a whole lot of trouble. We would have a really nice, peaceful relationship with the people who love us if we just shut up. You know, if you don't have anything nice to say, don't say anything at all. You know what? That is just so true. It's so easy. It's so easy. And so much would be fixed. And you know, when you feel it, you know, it's like. Ask for forgiveness before you got this beautiful, juicy thing that you want to say.